Then, if the arts and letters implicitly organized society, then whoever controlled the artistic and literary production could therefore control a lot more than what was on the page or the easel. Indeed, Du Bois considered great artists and writers to be as useful as the warriors who won military battles for their princes, because they could spread the feelings of religion or politics that provided the undergirding for social behavior. However, as Du Bois laid it out in his Critical Reflections on Poetry and Painting, published 1719, the world of arts and letters was not to be merely dictated by the will of a monarch, no matter how powerful he was. Despite the effects of patronage, works of art and literature do not develop out of a vacuum, but in the context of their day. The contemporary audience had to necessarily be taken into consideration, especially at the turn of the century, since the printing press had greatly increased the availability of reading material, and subsequently the body of potential critics of any given work had known a veritable explosion. By the early 18th century, public judgment was no longer under the control of the king or his ministers. This might have been the first feeling of trolling. Du Bois, given his career as a diplomat, which at this time basically meant propagandist, was interested in understanding this new public taste. As we mentioned last time, the public in the 17th century was considered to judge according to their senses and their passions, and not their reason. They were thus untrustworthy arbiters, given the volatility of their senses. Not so, contended Du Bois. Du Bois was Lockean, meaning he followed John Locke's view that all knowledge comes first and foremost from experience, and not, as Descartes had maintained, innate ideas. While the professional critics judged works of art and literature based on their adherence to a specific set of criteria set down by Aristotle over 1,000 years before, without reference to their experience of the work, the public only judged works based on their senses. Their experience was all they had to go on. Du Bois flipped the script for aesthetic judgments, stating that only by listening to the senses can we make reliable judgments, and that anyone who started with general principles to deduce the value of a work was very likely to fall into error. Du Bois essentially democratized the judging function. In a letter to Bayle, he wrote, quote, "Often a reflective, private individual has ideas that escape the penetration and notice of ministers," end quote. We can think way ahead here to Beaumarchais' revolutionary Figaro play, which was 1778-84. And I'd like just to make a side note here. Du Bois' idea of the public was not completely inclusive as our own might be today. He was really talking about what he would term a public instruit, or an instructed public, those who had received at least some level of education or had developed a comparative taste through their ability to read and or to travel. However, it was still progress. Du Bois's idea of the public was elitist, but it was not exclusive as a rule. Anyone could gain access to it if they equipped themselves with the contemplative capacities. Moreover, he considered this group to be on the rise and sincerely hoped that the printing press would soon allow everyone the possibility of reading the great works of literature. Of course, Du Bois did not mean that the public voice was infallible. Public taste would depend on many things. During his career, Du Bois had traveled all over and become acquainted with the different habits and morals of different peoples. He understood that the taste of each population had to be courted on its own terms. This is the notion of bienséance in French. For example, in his efforts to win public opinion for Louis XIV during the War of the Spanish Succession, he wrote a speech for several different countries. It was the same speech delivered in each country, but without any of the same words. In France, His speech was a paragon of succinct eloquence. In England, he never strayed from the idea of political economy. In Italy, he played the part of an outraged priest, describing the desecrations of church altars and the raping of nuns if the English should prevail in their claim over the French. And for Germany, he just went on, with almost no attention to what the French would consider elegance. You see, at this time, climate was considered to produce different ranges of knowledge, concern, and experiences. People from different climates and lands were made up differently, which in turn affected the competence of each people to judge certain works. The notion of climate affecting the humors of people goes back actually to ancient Greece with Hippocrates and was much more fully developed in the 16th century in Spain with the very interesting work of Juan Huarte de San Juan, where he tried to draw a link between physiology and what we would now call psychology. He believed that elements like heat and moisture in the individual would have major effects on their temperament and intellect. So, for example, he thought young people's minds were very moist, which gave them a wonderful memory, but it was dryness that gave understanding. So the older a person gets, the drier their brain gets, the more understanding they have, but less memory. Dubose understood that there was no perfectly objective point of view. Each judging individual brought with him or her their own personal disposition that would inflect their perception of the work. But getting back to art, did that mean that all judgment was relative? Not at all. Rather, a judgment of a work as beautiful would be considered a valid judgment of beauty if that work could be demonstrated to have been considered beautiful by many different populations and different kinds of populations over many different periods. We can think of Homer's Iliad or Brunelleschi's Santa Maria del Fiore, Michelangelo's David, Raphael's Sistine Madonna, Da Vinci's Last Supper, Mona Lisa, etc. Dubose is gesturing here to the idea of a universal taste. He stated that, and I quote, "The uniform testimony of the senses of other men is, after the testimony of our own senses, the most certain means we have to judge the merit of things that affect our sentiment," end quote. So it wasn't the idea of merely copying the old masters that would produce beauty, in Dubose's estimation, but rather the contemplation of their works in addition to the contemplation of one's own contemporary notion of beauty, figuring out the common thread that linked these two otherwise very disparate forms and moments of beauty that would lead one toward the idea of the universal taste. It was a system of aggregation, yes, but one that also necessitated a discerning eye. And this judgment was theoretically accessible to everyone due to the expansion of literacy and printed works. This was therefore a far cry from the previous century, during which the great statesman Richelieu opposed the education of the masses, stating, quote, "Just as a body that had eyes in all its parts would be monstrous, so would a state be the same if all subjects were knowledgeable. Obedience would be as rare as pride and presumption would be common."